YouTuber Gaurav Taneja, aka Flying Beast, made a tweet a few days back. He's an IIT graduate and I was surprised to see him buy into this kind of bullshit. Just goes to show no matter how educated you are, you can still fall prey to it. We're gonna look at this claim, analyze where it comes from, and talk about such religious science claims in general. For those who don't know Gaurav Taneja, which I think is very few of you, his YouTube channel is called Flying Beast. He uploads daily vlogs and uses the cuteness of his children for clickbait. This he has been criticized for a lot. But whatever you may think, he is a very skilled YouTuber, very well respected in the vlogging community. His vlogs get a million plus views every day. He has a loyal fan base and I expect this video to be getting a ton of dislikes soon. But I must do what I do on this channel, which is fight irrationality being spread by these pages. But this time it's not just another huge YouTube channel. It's run by an IIT Kharagpur alumnus, a qualified pilot, a bodybuilder, and someone who has recently gotten into studying law. But no amount of education can remove the years of religious indoctrination as shown by this tweet. But you know what? Let's not jump to conclusions. Let's actually analyze what he said in this tweet, because hey, you can make extraordinary claims, you just have to back it up with extraordinary evidence. Let's see what evidence he actually provides. Two families survived the Bhopal gas tragedy by doing Agnihotra. That's the fire ceremony that you can see him doing in this picture here. Now, the Bhopal gas tragedy was a factory accident that took place in 1984, where this highly toxic gas called MIC, Methyl Isocyanate, leaked in the city of Bhopal, leaked into residents' houses, and thousands of people lost their lives. Now, if you want to learn what led up to the accident and what happened after it, I highly recommend Dhruv Rathee's video. I've linked it in the description. Now, where does this claim come from? All sources point to a newspaper article that was apparently published in 1985, which talks about these two families that woke up on the night of the tragedy vomiting because of the poisonous gases, toxic gases, and instead of evacuating like any sane family would, they decided to sit and do Agnihotra, and within 20 minutes their symptoms of gas poisoning vanished. Now, how can that be possible when methyl isocyanate is flammable? It burns, producing even more toxic gases like hydrogen cyanide and carbon monoxide, etc. How on earth can you perform a fire ceremony in its presence? Hey, in case you don't die by breathing in MIC, you can ensure that you burn your entire house down by doing this. Okay, let's assume that the gas is not flammable, or maybe it wasn't an insufficient enough quantity to catch fire noticeably. Even then, there is a logical fallacy when you come to this conclusion, when you say that the Agnihotra is what saved the lives of those people. Let's see what it is. We don't know how much of this claim is true, especially given that MIC is flammable. This newspaper article sounds like a WhatsApp forward by someone who wanted to use a tragedy involving the deaths of thousands of people to promote their version of superiority of their religion. Even if you assume the details of the story to be true, this conclusion that has been drawn has a logical flaw in it. When you say that A happened and then B happened, therefore A caused B, you're mistaking correlation for causation. The Agnihotra and the family surviving the tragedy are two events that are correlated. But if you conclude that they survived because of this Agnihotra, then you are committing this fallacy. You're ignoring all the other factors that may have been bigger reasons for why they survived. Like how much of the toxic gas was in the air? What was the airflow like that night with respect to the houses? What was the wind speed and direction in the location? And how far away was the house from the factory? And how did all these factors affect how much toxic gases were in the air? We shouldn't jump to conclusions without a clear knowledge of all these factors, especially when the claim we're making is extraordinary like this. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. I'm not rejecting the claim, I'm simply not accepting it because there is no convincing evidence. But when it comes to Gaurav Taneja's claims on the scientific superiority of the Vedic scriptures, it doesn't stop there. Let's see what else he said. In this video uploaded on August 8, 2019, he talks about how, although we see things from this lens of modern science in the world today, as we get older and we learn more about the world, we start losing our belief in modern science and we start trusting the Vedas and our scriptures. He says how there's all the science in the Bhagavad Gita, how it talks about atoms and electrons and protons, which honestly is a load of bullshit. And I'll explain why. Science is a method. It is not a body of knowledge. It is not a list of facts and theories or a list of solutions to problems. It is a way of thinking, a way of learning things about the world primarily through observation, a way of figuring out how true something is and if it should go in such a list or not. I have an entire playlist on my channel on the scientific method. Feel free to watch. Now, someone comes to me and says that there's this book from centuries ago which talks about atoms and electrons and protons and the theory of evolution, and they figured all this out without using the scientific method, then whatever that book says cannot be called scientific. They may be true or false, but definitely not scientific. We learned about electrons and protons through careful experimentation and observation. We learned about evolution through observation. Can you tell me back when the Bhagavad Gita was written, how could they have performed the experiments that led to those conclusions? They couldn't have. But Pranav, you ask, if they weren't using the scientific method, how were they right? I have two answers for your question. One, given what you know today, you try and force fit modern discoveries and try and find parallels that are there in the scriptures that match with modern discoveries, modern theories, modern facts that we discovered recently. And you tend to ignore everything else that doesn't match with anything that we know today. This is a combination of hindsight bias and confirmation bias. The other reason is, imagine you're in a dark room. Somewhere in the room there is a dartboard and you have a bunch of darts with you. If you start throwing the darts, what percentage of them will hit the mark? A very low percentage, right? You can see how it's not 0%. Even if you throw randomly in some direction, you could hit the bullseye. It's unlikely, but you could hit it. Right. Now imagine if the room was dimly lit. You can make out some details in the room. You can see roughly where the dartboard is, and that helps you throw better, making your throws get a higher percentage accuracy. And what if the room was well lit? Your accuracy would go up tremendously, right? The chance of you not hitting the mark will only depend on how good or bad your aim is. The same way back when these books were written, if there are things that turned out to be factually correct in these books, there are those small percentage of shots in the dark that hit their mark. A huge number of these statements are just plain false, but you ignore them and pick only the ones that are true, knowing what you know today. And you call them scientific. What logic is this? Things like Ayurveda probably did a lot of trial and error before arriving at their results, and they probably had better accuracy. Much like the dimly lit room from my example. But simple trial and error is prone to a lot of mistakes which are overcome by modern medical trials. I've gone into that extensively in this video. Plus, we had no knowledge of germ theory before the 17th century. Plus, with advancements in chemistry and biology, we knew the mechanisms in which these medicines work. And that has helped us design much more better medications for certain conditions. We also have ways of evaluating the safety of medicines, which we didn't have back then. Ayurveda may have achieved results many centuries ago, doesn't mean it's the best tool we have today. There is a very prevalent narrative that Ayurveda is superior to modern medicine. I've heard many people say it. Please don't buy into it. What we have today is like my third example, a much brighter room. Of course, we can miss, but the chance of hitting are much, much higher than anything we had in the past. And plus, you don't need to establish your religion, culture, or tradition as scientific. Only people with an inferiority complex will do that. Your culture is beautiful as it is. Don't embarrass yourself by posting tweets like these. Now, there is a chance that he knew exactly what he was doing. He didn't actually believe what he said, but he said that only to please the his audience or he knew his audience really well, and he knew the majority of his audience would like a post like that, and that's why he posted it. In which case, I don't really have a lot to say about him. He's just being really manipulative, and if people don't recognize that, they can fall into traps like these. So
Yeah.
And the next time you see someone say some modern scientific fact is mentioned in scripture, just remember they're just shots in the dark. Some may hit the mark, doesn't mean they were aimed. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.